Today is the 11th day of the 12th month on our Maker's restored calendar. It is February 6th on his servant Satan's calendar. In a recent video, I said that the Most High has been bringing the pieces of the puzzle of his end time timeline together in an increased way. He has indeed been doing so. And last night, after he caused me to produce the video, "You have prepared your firstborns for the slaughter," he revealed a whopper piece of the puzzle to me. I will explain this whopper to you. First, it is important to understand that he has given many of his end time prophecies to us in four parts. He has done so in order to parallel the four horns of his altar that are going to bud forth at this time. These four horns represent his four spirits of wisdom, understanding, counsel, and knowledge. For instance, the testimony of his word gives us four dates for the opening wide of his end-time son of Adam's mouth. The testimony of his word also gives us four dates for his Haggai prophecies that are for his two anointed sons, Yeshua and Zerubbabel, and those that will stand with us to do work on his house. His word also puts an emphasis upon three of this or that in relation to four of this or that in several of his end-time prophecies. The third of the four dates of his Haggai prophecies tell us the following. "Because thus says Yahweh of hosts, in one little continuance, I will shake the dual heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry ground. And I will shake all of the heathens, and the pleasant of all of the heathens will come, and I will fill this house with glory, says Yahweh of hosts. The silver is mine and the gold is mine, says Yahweh of hosts." This one little continuance of time is referring to a little continuance of time from the date of this prophecy, which is the 21st day of the 7th month, to the time that Yahweh shakes the dual heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry ground. The 21st day of the 7th month is the last day of the 7 days of Yahweh's Feast of Huts. This day was the last day of the 1260 days of his 42-month witness against the scattered descendants of Israel. And it is also the last day of the appointed times, and half of an appointed time that we are now in. In light of what the Most High's only begotten Son spoke on this day, Yahweh's orchestrating these two periods of time to end on this waypoint indicator is awesome. Yeshua spoke the following on this day, given to us in John chapter 7. "And on the last day, the great day of the feast, Yeshua stood and cried aloud, saying, If anyone thirst," referring to for Yahweh's righteousness in his kingdom, "let him come to me and drink, and believe into me according to the scripture that says, streams of living waters will flow out of his belly." Yahweh's word calls the center stone of his altar that he has reared up in your midst at this time the bosom stone. It is out from this belly stone that he is sending forth his living waters at this time. I will expand on this in another video because right now I want to stay focused on last night's revelation. The fourth date of Yahweh's Haggai prophecies is 63 days after the 21st day of the 7th month. It is the 24th day of the 9th month. Yahweh's word came to his servant Haggai twice on this fourth waypoint indicator. The last day of this appointed times, and half of an appointed time, is 2 years after the last day of the 1260 days of Yahweh's 42-month witness against you. The first of his two 24th day of the 9th month prophecies tells us the following. "On the 24th day of the 9th month, in the second year of Darius, Yahweh's word was to Haggai the prophet, saying," the name Haggai comes from the Hebrew word for feast. Therefore, his name is associated with Yahweh's feast. In light of what his Feast of Huts or his Feast of Temporary Dwellings represents, it is indeed fitting that the third of these four Haggai dates is for the last day of this feast. Verse 11, "Thus says Yahweh of hosts, ask now the priest about the Torah, saying, Behold, though the flesh of a holy man lifts up the wing of his garment, and the wing touches to bread, or to soup, or to wine, or to oil, or to any food, are they sanctified? And the priest answered and said, No. Then Haggai said, If an unclean life touches any of these, will it be unclean? And the priest answered and said, It will be unclean. I can assure you that it is not a coincidence that Kikwe's anointed deems everything that we bring into his camp that the walking dead have even touched to be unclean. Everything that we bring into his camp needs to be sanctified before we eat it or use it. Do any of you obey him in this matter? Do you put a difference between the clean and the unclean with anything? His word tells us that he is going to send his wrath upon you because you do not put a difference between the clean and the unclean. Why don't you believe him? In verse 14, and Haggai, the man of the feast, answered and said, likewise is this people unclean, and likewise is this heathen nation before my face is unclean, says Yahweh. And likewise is every work of their dual hands unclean, and so is that which they approach to me with, they're unclean. I beseech you at this time to set your heart from this day forward to before a stone was set to a stone in Yahweh's palace. To before a stone was set to a stone in his palace is a prophetic reference to before he rose up his house in your midst at this time. He set up the boulder design of his palace after the 1,260 days of his 42-month witness against you. Therefore, this prophecy is referring to you setting your heart upon the 1,260 days of his 42-month witness against you. Set your heart upon that which he spoke to you during this time. And then this prophecy gets truly amazing. It will be that you will come to a heap of 20, and there will be 10. And you will come to a wine vat to uncover 50, and there will be 20 in the wine press. This is a prophecy that is for today's video and the first day of the fourth month, the first day of the first month that is 20 days from today. The heap is referring to the heaps that he is going to begin to bring into the depository of his house. There are 10 days that encompass the first day of the first month and the day that he commands us to set aside the goats or the lambs for his Passover memorial that is 4 days later. 50 days prior to the first day of the first month is the 11th day of the 11th month. This is the day that Yahweh caused his servant Noah to let loose the first dove. 20 days after the first day of the first month is the last day of his 7-day feast of that which is unleavened. This verse marks today's waypoint in relation to the first day of the first month in a remarkable way. I will smite you with a blighting and a withering and with hail on all of the work of your dual hands, because you were not to ail, says Yahweh. I beseech you to set your heart from this day forward, the 24th day of the 9th month, and set your heart from the day of the founding of Yahweh's palace. Does the seed not continue in the fright of the sojourning? Have not the vine and the fig tree and the pomegranate and the olive tree lifted up to bless you from this day? The Hebrew word that I translated, the fright of the sojourning, is a word that is only used two other places in the testimony of Yahweh's word. And in both places it refers to fright, as in fear. However, it is a word that comes from the Hebrew word that means to sojourn or to be turned aside. Therefore, it means the fright of the sojourning. It is referring to the fight that is soon going to be let loose upon you. This verse tells us that there was going to be a gap in this, that Yahweh was not going to remove these things from you. He was going to continue to bless you. But this is going to change, because Yahweh goes on to give us the second leg of his 24th day of the 9th month prophecy. He goes on to tell us the following in the next verse. Yahweh's word came to Haggai a second time on the 24th day of the 9th month, saying, speak to Zerubbabel, the governor or the head of Judah, saying, I will shake the dual heavens and the earth. I will overthrow the thrones of kingdoms, and I will destroy the power of the kingdoms of the heathen, and I will overthrow their chariots, and those that ride in them, and their horses, and their riders will be cast down, each man by his brethren's sword. And that day, says Yahweh of hosts, I will bring my servant Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, says Yahweh, and I will put a signature ring upon him, because I have chosen him, says Yahweh of hosts. This is all quite amazing. When the 24th day of the 9th month has passed these past few years, nothing major has happened. And this coming year's 24th day of the 9th month will occur after this appointed times, and half of an appointed time is over. Therefore, the Most High had to have hidden something in these 4 dates that he has not revealed until now. And he did. Like I said earlier, the 24th day of the ninth month is 63 days after the third date that he gave to us through his servant Haggai. I will put what he told us concerning this third date, the 21st day of the seventh month, back up on the screen. Because thus says Yahweh of hosts, in one little continuance I will shake the dual heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry ground. And I will shake all of the heathens, and the pleasant of all of the heathens will come, and I will fill this house with glory, says Yahweh of hosts. The silver is mine and the gold is mine, says Yahweh of hosts, clearly associating him doing so with him bringing the silver and the gold into his house. Since the 24th day of the ninth month is 63 days after this 21st day of the seventh month waypoint, and since he associates his shaking the dual heavens and the earth with the 24th day of the ninth month, obviously the small continuance of time is referring to 63 days. The third date and the fourth date of his Haggai prophecies establish a code that is for a 63-day period of time. It just so happens that the 63rd day of my approaching to the Most High on the most holy place on planet Earth to petition my Elohim to uncover his almighty arm will be 20 days from today on the first day of the first month. The testimony of his word places huge significance upon this waypoint indicator. The first day of the first month is the last day of the first appointed time of the appointed time, appointed times, and half of an appointed time that we are now in. The first day of the first month is one of the four dates that Yahweh's end-time Son of Adam prophecies give to us for the opening wide of his end-time Son of Adam's mouth. It is actually the third of these four dates because it was given to us in the 27th year. The first of them is the 10th day of the 10th month in the 9th year. The second of them is the 6th day of the 10th month of the 12th year. And since the fourth of these waypoints was given for the 30th year, it is also yet to come. This fourth date was given to us for the 5th day of the 4th month. There are 21 years that separate these four dates. The Most High revealed this to me about the 63rd day of my petition last night when we were 21 days from the first day of the first month. These 21 years parallel things like the 21 days of his servant Daniel's petition. The first day of the first month was the day that Yahweh caused his servant Moses to rear up the tent of his appointed times in the wilderness. He did so in the second year from when he brought them out from Egypt. The first day of the first month is also the day that he caused his servant Noah to remove the covering from the ark. It is the day that our ancestors left Babylon for Jerusalem in the days of Ezra the priest. It is the day that our ancestors agreed to have finished the putting away of their wives that were strangers to the Most High. It is the day that Hezekiah began to have Yahweh's house sanctified. It is also the day that Yahweh tells his end-time son of Adam to cleanse his sanctuary that is in his house. Is this small continuance of time ending on the first day of the first month the last of Yahweh's warnings? Or is it the day that he will indeed begin to shake the dual heavens and the earth through the signature ring that he has put upon my hand? We will soon find out because, like I said, this waypoint is just 20 days from today. It will fall on February 26th on his servant Satan's calendar. When he gave this date to us as one of the four dates that he gave to us for the opening wide of my mouth, he told us the following in Ezekiel chapter 29. It was in the 27th year on the first day of the first month, his word was to me saying, Son of Adam, Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, made his army to enslave a great bondage upon Tyrus. Tyrus is a prophetic reference to the physical wealth that is found in the captivity of Mystery Babylon at this time, and particularly in the chief seat of this captivity, which is the United States of America. Every head was made bald, every head was made uncovered, and every side was furbished, every side was made uncovered, and he did not give wages to his army for the bondage of Tyrus that he had enslaved upon them. The bondage of Tyrus is referring to the bondage of the wealth that Yahweh has given to you. Yahweh is going to show you your baldness. He is going to show you that you are not under his covering. He is going to show you the shame of your nakedness before his faces. Verse 19, therefore thus says Yahweh Elohim, behold, I gave the land of Egypt, referring to the land of the captivity, to Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and he carried up her multitude, and he plundered her possessions, and the spoil that they took was the wages for his army. This plunder and the spoil for their wages is symbolic of the false shepherds of Israel receiving their rewards in the form of plundering the tithes and the offerings from their flocks that they have helped keep in the captivity. Verse 20, I gave them the land of Egypt for their labor, so that they served against them, because they did this for me, says Adonai Yahweh. In that day, referring to in this day, I will cause the horn of the house of Israel to bud forth, and I will give to you, son of Adam, the opening of your mouth in the midst of them, and they will know that I am Yahweh. Here is a summary of what is being given to you today. The Most High established a 63-day period of time between the third and the fourth days that he gave to us through his servant Haggai. He has caused his end-time son of Adam to approach him three times a day. And now he has revealed to his servant that the 63rd day of my petition will be on the third of the four dates that he gave to us for the opening wide of my mouth. Do you think that these details are just coincidences? I think not. Nor is the fact that he tells us that the gold and the silver are his in association with the third of the four dates of his Haggai prophecies. He caused the heaps to be brought into his house from the third month until the seventh month after he caused his servant Hezekiah to sanctify his house. Something obviously changed at that time before the third month to cause our ancestors to bring in this abundance into the depository of Yahweh's house. The first day of the first month brings forth a 60-day period that will precede the third month. These 60 days include the Most High's two opportunities that he gave to us to do his Passover memorial. Yahweh sent the floodwaters gushing upon the inhabitants of the world during this 60-day period. He did so on the 17th day of the second month. This was 3 days' journey from his backup Passover opportunity. He caused it to take our ancestors 60 days to reach Horeb after he brought them out from Ramesses. He brought forth the waters from the rock during their 60-day journey. One thing is for sure, Yahweh has already sent his servant to you with volumes of warnings such as this, and one day these warnings will cease from being warnings. I spoke of some of the significance of the number 63 in relation to Psalm 63 in a recent video that was called Jerusalem, a Cup of Trembling. 63 is the third of four sets of 21 Psalms that exist between Psalms 1 and Psalm 84. The significance of 84 is discussed throughout these videos in relation to the 84 hours that his two anointed sons are dead. Folks, the details like this that the Yahweh has woven into his end-time timeline that he had recorded in the testimony of his word are beyond incredible. If you cannot acknowledge his incredible design of this 63-day code that he gave to us through his servant Haggai, you are simply being stiff-necked and obstinate. Here is something that is for sure. You are either going to bring your gold and your silver to Yahweh's house and return that which is his anyway to him, or you are going to cast it into the streets and cry out for the rocks to fall on you. The problem for those of you that are not going to return that which is his to him is that his word tells us about a 5-month period of time that you are not going to be able to die, so calling upon the rocks to fall on you is not going to help you. In light of your stealing from him all of this time, and in light of your failure to sustain his anointed that he has sent to you, and in light of the bondage of Tyrus that has seized you, it is awesome that Yahweh has put so much emphasis upon his liquidation sale and your need to bring that which he has given to you to possess to the depository of his house. He has made this a matter of putting your money where your heart is. If your heart is upon his house, this is where your money will be. If it is upon your life here in the flesh, you will be burnt up with that which he has given to you. The question that remains to be seen is how much affliction is he going to have to send upon you to cause your heart to change? Will your firstborn's dying do so? We will soon see.